I want to welcome you and thank you for joining us here. And with that, I will toss over to our moderator, Jason, from a fabulous organization called MindBodyGreen, who will introduce himself and our wonderful keynote presenter here. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone, for coming. So my name is Jason Wachob. I'm the founder of MindBodyGreen.com. We are the leading digital media destination for holistic wellness. And so I'll tell you a little bit about me, why I'm here. I don't know if you could probably tell, I'm not exactly small. I'm actually 6'7". I played college basketball at Columbia. Soon after college, I worked on Wall Street as a trader. And then once I paid off that mountain of Columbia debt that I accrued, I got into other things and got into the startup world. A couple years ago, I found myself running an organic cookie company. We were in every Whole Foods in the country. I also met my wife around that time, so I was revisiting spirituality. I was really revisiting the importance of ingredients, eating more organic, paying attention to the toxins we were putting into our homes and our bodies. And I also flew insane mileage that year. I flew almost 200,000 miles domestic. And this 6'7" body in a little coach airline seat was literally destroying my lower back. So I had two extruded discs pressing on my sciatic nerve. I was in excruciating pain. There were days I could barely walk. I went to two doctors, both of whom said, you need surgery. As a last-ditch effort, I started practicing yoga. And voila, I am completely healed. I'm totally fine. So I had these series of moments where I said, wow, like having some sort of spiritual practice, incorporating mindful movement, preferably yoga, eating organic, ridding our homes and our bodies of toxins, this is the solution to health. Like we have this incredible health toolkit within us and there's a global health problem and people are looking for solutions and this is it. And yoga became a primary tool for me. It's something I still practice every day. And that led me to actually Tara, and I live in New York, and one of the benefits of being in New York is to practice yoga with Tara. And what we're trying to do at MindBodyGreen is make wellness more approachable and accessible, and Tara is doing this with yoga and bringing more people into yoga around the world. People like Deepak Chopra, Jane Fonda, Brooklyn Decker, Tia Mowry, like the list goes on. And including myself, they all go to Tara for yoga. And why I'm here, and I think why you're here today, if yoga like literally cured my back, like there is an x-ray of my back and you could see the discs like going off on the side. And if you were to take that x-ray today, like it's perfect, it's fine. So if yoga could do that for my back, you know, what else can it do? I'm gonna here's Tara. You're gonna tell them what it can do.
Yeah, yeah. anyway, yeah, thanks for coming. We're both really excited to be here. I'm Tara Stiles. Everything that I do revolves around this idea of finding the ease, and yoga is a great system that we all can do. You know, you don't have to be flexible. You don't have to put your foot behind your head. You don't have to move away to an ashram. Literally, you can just sit and breathe and do some simple movements to help your body work better, help your brain function better, and you really feel better from the inside out. So I have a nice yoga studio downtown New York, so when you come visit, come to yoga, we'll have a good time. And we're probably gonna be opening one here in LA soon, so come visit that one. And it's just really exciting for me to get to work with everybody and see how it's affected so many lives. So today I wanna share with you a little bit about how yoga works in the brain and all this cool stuff, just really get y'all excited so you feel all of those things working and know that it's not necessarily, you know, all the misconceptions with yoga, like, oh, why do I feel that way? Or how is that, you know, really gonna change my life? How is some stretching going to do anything? And there's a lot of amazing women that I've met, both at the yoga studio in New York and other places, and also online that have had really cool transformations, not only with yoga and fertility, but all different kinds of ways with stress and dealing with their bodies and just being comfortable in who they are and really feeling not just comfortable and empowered, but beyond that, really radiant and excited. So I think before we get too started with everything and chit-chatting, yoga is nice to talk about, but it's experiential. I think we should do some yoga. What do you think? Be good? You guys up for it?
All right.
So even people online, if you're at home online, just stand up. We'll just do a couple minutes, really. Nothing too crazy. So you can even do yoga in your jeans here, which is awesome, or your, whatever you're in. Awesome. So just take a nice stance here. And just for a moment, close your eyes. Start to draw your attention a little deeper inward. And just let everything soften a little bit here. So soften your knees, soften your neck and shoulders. And then gently bring your palms together right in front of you and plug your thumbs right up into your heartbeat here. Just see if you can find your heart pumping for you. So all together, take a big inhale up through your nose. And long exhale out through your mouth. Twice more, just like that. Big inhale. And easy exhale. Last one, big inhale. And easy exhale. Nice. And just gently open your eyes here. Yeah, so take a big inhale, reach your arms all in and up. And then from here, grab a hold of your right wrist with your left hand. That's it. And then just take a big inhale, lift all the way upward here. And then so much up that maybe you just run out of up and start tipping over. Yeah, and just staying really soft, maybe even sway a little side to side, just finding that ease in your body. Yeah, you guys look great. And when you're ready, slowly bring it back to your middle and stay on the other side. Grab a hold of the other wrist. Big inhale to stretch all the way up. Nice. And so much that you reach right on over. Just breathe easy here. Nice. Another big inhale. Reach it all the way up. Open up. And then exhale. Just relax your arms down by your sides. Yeah. Okay. So just stretch your feet a little bit apart here. Step your feet a little bit apart. And then we'll bring your left toes out to the left. And then the right toes just come a little bit in. So this becomes a little hip opener here, which is feels real nice. So take a big inhale, reach your arms out. Yeah, everybody's doing it. And then just sink your hips down here. So nice kind of mini warrior too. Yeah. You are warriors. All right. So the great thing, you know, you're getting all improved blood flow, circulation. We'll go into a little bit more about how yoga works in the brain and all the really cool expansive things that happen there. So good stuff. So take a big inhale, lift everything all the way up. And then exhale, soften right back into your warrior two. Nice. Two more just like that. Big inhale, lift everything up. And then exhale, soften and relax here. One more just like that. Big inhale, take up all the space. And then exhale, move right into that space. Yeah, and then just other side. Got to be even. So just turn the right toes out and then the left toes come a little bit in. All right, so big inhale, reach everything up. And then exhale, just sink into it. Nice. And again, just hanging out here, breathing for a little while. Relaxing your shoulders. Nice, calm gaze. So another neat thing about holding poses like this, you start to feel finding the ease with just a little bit of effort. So your muscles are just doing a little something here, but instead of getting tense or tired, just bringing your attention right back to your breath. Yeah, so again, take a big inhale, lift everything all the way up, and then exhale, sink right back. And you guys are so good. Two more just like that. Big inhale, lift everything up, and then exhale, soften and relax. One more time like that. Big inhale, take up all the space. And exhale, move right into it. Nice.
After getting off a flight, this feels really good.
Right? Okay, just come all the way back in. So last one we'll do here, just shift your weight into your left leg and just hug your right knee into your chest. Give it a good squeeze. Yeah, that's fun, right? Yeah, bless you. All right, so tree pose here. So any kind of tree, you want to be in the forest. If balance feels pretty easy today, maybe bring the foot up high. If that's not so much fun in jeans or your pants, you just bring your toes down to the ground too. Yeah, nice. Awesome. So there's always movement and balance, which is really cool. You never see a tree like holding its breath, like standing really stiff. So just letting yourself just sway a little bit in the breeze. So there's always those little corrections. Just like driving a car, if you held the steering wheel tight, you know, you'd run off the road, but you have to make all those little, yeah. You guys are an awesome forest. I love it. Yeah, so just same thing other side here. Just give that other knee a good squeeze in. And then tree pose on this side. So again, if you're really feeling like a high tree or a low tree, thankfully trees are all different, keeping the forest interesting. Imagine if all the trees were looking the same way. And again, just a little sway, a little side to side, just to have all that movement that lives right inside bounds. Yay, this is fun. Awesome, then just gently come back to the middle. So the last one is just a nice breathing technique you can do any time of day. It's called alternate nostril breathing. It really improves
blood flow.
Yeah, I should do it to improve some blood flow to the brain and helps with circulation and you just overall feeling good. So this is real simple. Just take the first two fingers of your right hand, like you're saying peace here, and then curl those two down so you're left with your ring finger and your thumb, and that's just enough space for your perfect nose in between there. So all together, just close off the left side of your nostril with your ring finger, and you can close your eyes if you want, or keep it open, whatever's more comfortable. And take a big inhale up through your right side. At the top of that, close off with your thumb, so holding all the air in just for a moment. And when you're ready, release the ring side, let the air drain out.
This is also great if you're ever stressed or if you're having trouble sleeping.
Yeah, Jason does it every night. Another big inhale up the other side. Out of the top, hold off, holding all the air in just for a moment. And when you're ready again, release the thumb, let the air drain out. So we'll just continue here just for a few moments in your own breathing, nice and smooth and easy, just alternating between the sides. And if you find your attention wandering anywhere at all, just see if you notice the wandering. You can guide it right back into your breath. Just a few big, deep breaths here. Nice. And once you had enough of that one, just gently relax your hands down by your sides. Awesome, guys. So again, take a big inhale, reach your arms all the way up over your head. The top again, close your eyes, bring your palms together, bring your palms right in front of your chest. And again, plug your thumbs back into your heartbeat here. And just see if this time you can actually feel your heart pumping for you. All together, take a big inhale up through your nose. And long exhale out through your mouth. Just twice more, just like that, big inhale. And easy exhale. Last one, big inhale, and long exhale. Nice. And just gently open your eyes. So you guys feel pretty good? Yeah, see, awesome. Cool, so do that every day, and you'll be perfect, and you'll feel great. No, there's nothing wrong with you already, but yeah, just little bits like that help. So just to clear up any misconceptions of, you know, you have to do 3 hours a day and get a guru and all that stuff, you know? So, when I got the invite to come here today, I was kind of a little bit puzzled thinking, you know, well, I haven't had a baby yet. You know, my husband's probably trying to knock me up the next few years, but we'll see how that goes. So we haven't tried yet. And then I remembered I have a really sort of interesting and special skill. I can get women pregnant. So we'll start here. This is my friend Lindsay. She has a gaggle of kids, and the one, see if I can make this little pointer work, there she is, Mia, so the kind of hipster one, I'm responsible for her. She kind of looks like me, right? So the next one, Bex, this is my friend, she makes a lot of YouTube videos and does a lot of yoga, and her latest one, Summer, the little one over there in the corner with the swagger, she's mine. But anyway, you know, all joking aside, a fair question is, you know, how can yoga actually help? So.
And how many, like, I remember these people coming to the studio.
Yeah.
Like, there's been, like, I think there's 6 kids or something have come in, like, the past year and a half from practicing
something
with you.
In the water there.
Yeah.
and that's a good point. You know, people come, and not necessarily sometimes they're trying. I'll share a story with you toward the end of a woman who's, you know, had a really interesting and sort of long journey of trying to conceive and with some pretty interesting outcomes there. But yeah, people, women that come through have gone through their entire pregnancy and have emailed Mike, he gets all our studio emails, you know, 15 minutes before class and say, I'm really bummed I missed class, I went into labor. You know, so they've been doing yoga all throughout and been, you know, it's really helped them, you know, not have a perfectly feeling pregnancy, but help them find the ease in whatever they're experiencing. So again, fair question is, how can yoga help? So this is a fun chart my friend Dr. Rudy Tanzi sent me. He's a neuroscientist at Harvard and friend of Deepak Chopra. So a cool like perk of being friends with Deepak Chopra is I get to hang out with all these science guys and ask them questions about like what's going on. So this is your brain on yoga here. So what happens when you practice regularly, and you have to practice regularly because it doesn't work if you just do it once or talk about it. And practicing with ease is also important. So you are how you practice. So you can practice yoga in a tense, sort of frustrated state as well. But if you practice with ease, all of these great things are going to happen. So if you can see on our little chart here, depression, anxiety, negative symptoms go way down, cognition, sleep.
That sounds good.
That
worked
for you, right? Sleep go way up. And attention go way up, which is great. So you start to
what
feel
did you say?
Attention. Oh, I just got that.
Okay, yeah. So mentally what happens, and we'll go into the brain a little bit more, but space opens up for your mind to clear. Intuition starts to enter the picture, so all these cool things happen when, oh, I feel like a friend's going to call me, and that friend calls, or Deepak calls it synchronicity, so all these little kind of happy coincidences start to happen. And there's an explanation for that in the brain, which is cool. So cortisol goes down, that's, you know, the stress hormone, GABA, dopamine, serotonin, all of those things that make you feel really good when you do things that make you feel really good, you can get that without the side effects of doing drugs and drinking through yoga, which is great. So so when all the parts that make us up are united, when all this stuff is happening, what happens feeling-wise is we feel grounded, connected, and at ease. So and from that settled space, a lot more room opens up for expansion. So this is your brain on yoga. And this is how people often say they feel when they're practicing yoga all the time. They start to feel radiant. They start to feel sort of, you know, this energy field around them, and it can be like woo-woo if you're talking about it, especially here in LA, like a lot of the yoga scene can be like, you know, flowers and trees and well, what's really going on? And that's great for the people that are already involved, but some people that may not be interested in yoga yet may be turned off because, you know, well, how is that woo-woo really working, right?
It can get a little weird.
It can get a little weird. But so there's, this is all backed up by a lot of really interesting studies that's happening now. So there was a nice study at the Harvard Medical School where they put a bunch of devices on these longtime meditators' brains, and they showed this area of the brain that yogis call the third eye. It's called the insula in the brain, and it's responsible for your intuition, your creativity, your attention, and your association to consciousness, really like who are we in the world. And that area really regulates the mind-body connection. So if you practice yoga, that area is going to be strong like a muscle, and it's starting to be really really looked at in science now, which is exciting because the science before was, yeah, do yoga, you may feel better, but it's kind of in the over here category. So it's becoming in the main sort of integrated health category. Let's see. So blood flow, sorry, I couldn't find a picture of anybody else. Just kidding. So blood flow is another interesting point. Yoga acts like a pumping system in your body, so you're really getting this nice internal massage. So every inhale really creates more space and room, and every exhale moves you in, so your organs are getting this nice sort of feeling. Do you feel like that when you do yoga?
I do. I like massages, too.
The external ones?
You do. There's definitely a high after. It's like people call it like a yoga high. As soon as you practice, you feel it's just this nice, like, blissful state.
Yeah,
for a couple of minutes.
And the neat thing from yoga toward traditional exercises, and again, I'll share my friend's story later, is it really works on you from the inside out. So you're not working on or worrying about getting your body in shape. What you're working on is getting you in touch with yourself. And what happens from there is, well, of course, your body is going to get into the shape that it's meant to be in. Of course, your body is going to have the space and find the ease to be healthy. Your brain is going to work better. You're going to feel good, but you're not going after that external goal. You're going after the feeling of feeling good.
And you end up getting that external goal anyway.
Yeah, it just happens.
Yeah. For someone who's lifted, I was, like I said, I played basketball and I lifted weights. I did everything. And yoga is the only thing I do now. Like, it's the ultimate. If you had to pick one thing to do for only 10 minutes a day, yoga, by far and away, beats everything.
This is a technique that we use on people in class at the end, and it's not voodoo or anything, don't worry. It's just a very simple shiatsu technique. And yoga, you know, as far as all the Far Eastern healing systems of movement, pushing on somebody, and you can do this, anybody can do this, you don't have to go through a 200-hour teacher training to push on somebody's ankles. But just a couple inches above somebody's ankle bone, pushing there, it works on guys too, but for women, it really helps to heal and stimulate all the reproductive organs. So that's just a...
So how do you push on that? Is it just this area?
Yeah, kinda you can like have a baby.
Do you want to...
You
my wife
baby?
May be watching, and should I lie
okay,
down?
Okay, yeah, go ahead, lie down. So if somebody's relaxed...
I can't even fit on the stage.
You can't even fit on the stage.
This is what happens.
Yeah.
Imagine me in a coach seat. I'll go halfway.
There you go. You go halfway.
Sort it out.
So it's important for them to be relaxed and also for you to be relaxed. So, I mean, if you guys have all noticed, like, walking into a room and then somebody else walks in who's kind of having a stressful day, that you feel that. It's not mysterious. So if I'm stressed out and I'm doing that, he's going to take on that in some capacity. That didn't feel good. Okay. So you just take your thumbs and you can sort of judge a couple inches above the person's ankle bone. and just apply some pressure. And you don't really have to do anything. You don't have to think about ponies and rainbows and, you know,
like,
and mystical
ponies.
Thoughts. Although ponies and rainbows are nice. But you just sort of push, and then you can eyeball the person. You know, you have to stare at them, be like, is it working? But, you know, you can look, and if you see his belly kind of moving up and down, that's a good sign, just showing that he's breathing pretty deeply into a nice trance. He's going to start levitating soon. And then you can kind of work down. You know, everybody likes a good feet pushing. So you got to work down, push. I'm just pushing, actually, into his ankle bone a little bit, inside of the leg a little bit. And then I like to just finish off with a little squeeze of the arches of the foot. So that just sort of ends it up. So
I like that. I'm going to stay here for a while.
He's going to stay here for a while. So that's something anybody can do. And, you know, it just goes along with helping the body find the ease and helping us find the ease. You know, sometimes our bodies just need a little help to be our bodies. And again, that's something I'll share later with my friend's story. It's, she said that very nicely. Oh, what happened to the, oh, there we go. Okay.
The clicker.
So, next slide, very exciting. So community spirit and support. And I used to think this stuff was like super cheesy cornball, and then I started doing a lot of yoga and, you know, have a yoga studio, and I became super cheesy and cornball. but you know, there is a lot to this whole like doing yoga in groups thing. You know, people come in at the studio and some of them become friends and some of them just see each other at yoga, but there is this sort of feeling of, you know, I'm here to listen to you, and the feeling of we're all here to improve ourselves, to feel better, and to have that idea, whether we want to call it like, you know, yoga community or, you know, community of people. You don't have to call it anything, but just being there for each other's has been really cool and has led to a lot of really interesting things. And yeah, the goal of yoga is to feel great. So, you know, this is a, you know, in one of the workshops at the studio, everybody kind of playing around doing this, but, you know, there's no goal. If you fall over, it doesn't matter. You know, I think that's, yoga can be like a precious moment sometimes, and it's like, I have my yoga here and I can't drop it. Because if I drop it, I don't know what will happen, but I won't drop it. But, you know, if you switch that goal and say, I have to be perfect in the pose, to I want to go after that feeling of feeling connected, feeling at ease, and feeling good. And it's for you, it's for you, it's for yourself. So that's important there. Again, you are how you practice. So being at ease, we definitely emphasize, you know, whenever somebody's trying too hard or, you know, and again, this isn't being lazy, like you're just gonna lie down and do nothing, but that's fine too sometimes. But finding the ease and a little bit of effort, you're really going to be able to be much more capable in your bodies, and that translates also into your life. So Deepak always explains this, you know, the idea of meditation is observing without getting involved. So if this is you and you're observing, you start to have this space inside of yourself and you just feel much more roomy and little things don't annoy you as much. Do you find that with yoga?
What?
OMG. it's not working. Okay.
Well, one thing you always talk about, you talk about this too a lot in class, is you say, you know, especially in cities like New York and LA, we're so good about going fast and like achieving and like not, and getting to work and cutting our commute and going from one thing to the other. What we're not good about is slowing down, and that's the beauty of yoga and help and becoming more mindful. Otherwise, we sort of lose that during the day, and it's just so important in everything.
Yeah, the one thing that yoga really does consistently for everybody I've seen is it teaches you how to pay attention to yourself. So
Right. You
start to notice when something's not going right in your body, rather than, you know, having it be, you know, 5 years before you notice that discomfort or that, you know, dis-ease that could lead to disease. So you start to really pay attention and make changes along the way and, you know, eat better. And you know, there's all these cool things. This is my friend Tia Mowry. I just helped her do a yoga DVD. She got into yoga after she had her son Cree. She had gained 60 pounds and wanted to, you know, get better in her body and lose weight, and she's an actress, and that's very important. It's very external, her whole lifestyle. And she got into yoga because she heard it was good to lose weight. And then all of these amazing things started to happen. She stopped caring about whether she was, you know, losing weight. She stopped weighing herself on the scale. She started eating better. She started feeling better, and it became all about how can I feel better? And she's just, you know, really great story of transformation in a very short period of time. And Tia is awesome. So again, just surrounded by healthy, happy lives. We have a lot of fun at the studio.
So, I just wanted to share my friend Christine's story. She's a writer, too, so she wrote it out for me, which is very convenient and eloquent. So, here's her story.
Okay, if I can get this to work. So I lived in Berkeley since 91 when I was an undergrad at UC Berkeley. This is a land with no lack of incense, tie-dyed t-shirts, and yoga studios. But I didn't find yoga here. I found yoga while living in New York City 20 years later when a friend of mine and I, in the most timid of manners, stepped into a class at Strala. We just wanted to get moving. We were both writers who sat at desks all day. We would never describe ourselves as athletic or coordinated. We both hated exercise classes. I disliked them because I felt so self-conscious in a classroom setting where my place in the spectrum, worse than the class, would be so marked. But we thought it would be good to get more flexible. We picked the studio because, in all frankness, it was conveniently located. In sum, we had no expectations. But there we were, with a yoga instructor in Tara, who would occasionally giggle to herself and bring laughter into the room, so that I began to equate yoga with delight, who welcomed us as if into her own home, who didn't make me feel like a failure because I struggled to hold down dog those first weeks. It was okay. I went back the next week, and then the next. I upped my visits to 2 times a week, sometimes 3 or 4 over the next year. What happened over the next year and a half at Strala was life-changing. But in order to tell you what changed, I feel like I should tell you a little bit about my relationship with my body. I've had a painful relationship with my body. In fact, I wanted to divorce myself from my body. It had let me down in so many ways. I'd assumed it would always disappoint me with all manner of pain. I was not nice to my body either. I starved it, I purged it, and I hurt myself in retaliation and in pursuit of control through my teenage years. In my late 20s, I was diagnosed with PCOS. It was an undiagnosed until a few years after my husband and I tried to conceive. When I saw my ovaries on the ultrasound, my first reaction was, they look like a pomegranate cross-section. They were filled with dozens of unpopped eggs, cysts, if you will. I cried when I found out, not because of grief, but because of relief, because I had found a name for what was wrong with my body. That I'd been chubby and sluggish and moody was not out of a lack of discipline, but because of a hormonal imbalance. That the root cause had been there all of the time. I cried because I was angry that I'd gone undiagnosed all of those years, and because the side effects of PCOS, easy weight gain, difficult weight loss, could have been mitigated. I had engaged in needless war with my body and with myself. And so, I had renewed hope. I exercised. I ran. But you see, when I worked out, I was like a fainting goat. I'd still run and want to pass out. Any strenuous weightlifting, it wasn't that I couldn't lift heavy stuff if I put my mind to it and pushed through the pain, and I'd go home with a migraine. I did stadium stairs and I'd vomit 14 times in an hour session. I know, it doesn't sound like fun, right? My personal trainer high-fived me for pushing through the pain each time. I love backpacking. I backpacked the Lost Coast and I backpacked through the Sierra Nevadas at altitude. My friends and I got used to the fact that I got altitude sickness before everyone else and I'd just puke up the mountain. And then I had a stroke in December 2006 at the age of 33, due to a PFO, a hole in the center of my heart. As a fetus, we breathe through our mother's blood, and so we have no use for our lungs. The blood flows from one side of the heart to the other, skipping our lungs through a hole in the central wall. When we start breathing air, that hole is supposed to close and route blood to our lungs, but in about 20% of us, it remains open to varying degrees. A small percentage of us have migraines due to that hole, and an even smaller percentage can have a stroke. On December 31st, 2006, I threw a clot into my brain and had a left thymic stroke, one that left me with a 15-minute short-term memory. Doctors closed the hole in my throat, a hole in my heart, a few months later. I was restricted from exercising until I healed. I was Dory the fish in Finding Nemo. I couldn't read anything other than People magazine for months. I couldn't read a novel for a year. I couldn't write fiction for nearly 2 years. And when my heart was ready a year later, I began running again. In earnest, I could run, I could breathe, I couldn't believe the freedom. There was still a lot of healing to do. Doctors are amazing, but after my stroke, I learned that medicine can only go so far. That last mile is a lonely road that doctors do not take alongside you. My neurologist told me as his parting words, "You've come a long way. You're lucky to be alive, but this is as far as I can take you." He was a wonderful neurologist who said this with the greatest of empathy, but it was the truth. This was as far as he could take me. The rest was up to me. And I pushed forward. I wrote every day, hoping to regain my ability to write, and I did. But you see, it wasn't until Strala that I finished my healing. When everything came together, my mind, my body, that last mile, my relationship between my mind and my body, that I realized there shouldn't be pain in wellness, there should be ease. That this new ability to breathe could connect my mind with my body, that every breath could heal. I spent a year not running. I thought, what if I just do yoga? What if I really just enjoy myself and my body? What if I slow down? To reiterate, there was still a lot of healing to do, stuff I didn't even expect to have healed. My husband and I were still struggling to have a child. I'd taken progesterone, taken fertility medications, lost weight, taken metamorphin therapy. It had been a 13-year-long road, one not without its share of, let's give up for a while, and let's try this or that again, and I guess our life would be fine if we didn't have a kid, conversations. I was approaching 40, and the door was closing. In the meantime, I was going to yoga. In the beginning, I trembled during Warrior II, but I take a deep breath, think of water, think of my body floating in water, take a deep breath, exhale, transition back to reverse warrior, take a deep breath, breathe, easy, slow. Tara's voice was in my head, sorry. Easy, breathe, slow. I was going to yoga, mostly relaxed, but some strong classes. For me, yoga wasn't about doing inversions or balancing on one arm. It was about 90 minutes with myself. I was going to yoga. I did crow. I couldn't believe that when the time came, I could balance my body on my knees. It took a breath and not force to do so. I was going to yoga, where people like Mike Taylor say things like, move like you like yourself. I had begun to like myself. The war with my body had finally ceased. I was going to Strala, where change was happening every single minute, without pain, without struggle. A work acquaintance once told me, Christine, if it were easy to be fit, everyone would be fit. Working out is supposed to be hard and painful. At the time, I nodded, but today I'd shake my head. It doesn't have to be that way. I happened to drop 15 more pounds over the course of my year at Strala. When I wasn't in New York City and I was in Berkeley, I popped in Tara's DVDs and did yoga at home. I happened to start eating better, not that I didn't enjoy my share of junk food, but when I found myself having a few bites of chocolate and then stopping when I had my fill. So many things happen to happen with yoga that it can't be a coincidence. And my backpacking didn't suffer either, because I happened to become more aerobically fit. Last fall, I found myself jogging up the Sierra trails that I'd previously struggled to walk. I happened to be happier, I happened to be more confident, and this spring, I happened to become pregnant. There she is. I didn't go into pregnancy without risks. I had chronic high blood pressure for a number of years and was at risk for preeclampsia. The first thing doctors did was take me off blood pressure medications I'd been taking for 10 years. I was a little worried. Every day during my pregnancy, I took my blood pressure. It never went above 125 over 84, and on the days and the day or two after I did yoga, my blood pressure stayed at or below 115 over 75. I happened to no longer need blood pressure medication. Without medications and with yoga, I happen to no longer have blood pressure as high as 160 over 120. Yoga kept me and my kids safe through gestation. I happen not to have morning sickness. I happen to have a completely textbook pregnancy. I'm now at 38 weeks pregnant, a milestone I never thought I would reach. At this point in pregnancy, I'm uncomfortable but healthy thanks to yoga. I did relaxed classes on DVD with a few modifications, no rocking on my belly, until the end of week 32, which in layman speak is 8-ish months. I did everything I could to get pregnant over the course of 13 years. I know deep in my heart that it was yoga that happened to be the variable of change. It was yoga that brought my body into balance, and I could see things become regular in a way that hadn't been before. I'm not scared of labor because I'm going into it with a Strala philosophy of breathing and moving with ease, because I now have faith in my body, and this is how Strala Yoga changed my life. So that's Christine. And then one nice thing to add, I know, right? Yay for Christine!
That's amazing.
It's amazing, right?
Right.
So last Thursday, in perfect timing with the fertility conference, little Penny was born! I know, very exciting. So this is something Christine texted me over Twitter direct message. Textbook amazing, positive delivery, thanks to yoga.
That's
so
awesome.
And the cool thing about Christine is I knew her as somebody who comes to yoga. She told me about her stroke. She told me that, you know,
she used to be a runner and does yoga. I mean, a lot of people have that transition. I didn't know about her struggle with trying to conceive. She mentioned to me once in passing that, you know, they had tried, but, you know, it wasn't working. She gave up. I didn't know the whole story. And then here we go. So that's a great story.
That's amazing.
Yeah. So yeah, there's Penny. She's in Berkeley. So I guess the main sort of takeaway that I'd love to park on you guys is there's no rules, there's no path, you know, this isn't like, you know, I'd hate to be a person telling anybody what to do besides to get connected with how you feel. So the main sort of moral for me in my life that works and in everybody's life that I've seen have great successful lives and careers and families and whatever the struggle is, whatever the circumstances in the life, they're always following their own tuition and they're always making their own rules. So I think that's important.
Don't let anyone tell you you can't do something, especially a doctor sometimes.
Sometimes, yeah. Yeah, you were supposed to have back surgery, right?
Yeah, well, thank God I didn't. And there was no, the first doctor when I went to, it wasn't even like, he was like, surgery. I'm like, well, I don't know if I want to get surgery. He's like, well, then you're going to be in pain. Like, there was no, that was it. So doctors are sometimes good at, doctors are great. Doctors save lives. Doctors are incredible at diagnostics, but it's always important to keep in mind, like, what they do is they do surgery and they prescribe pills, and that's what they do well. And sometimes that's great, and sometimes that, you know, it doesn't work great. It's not a, you know, or we're not a one-size-fits-all for everything, and sometimes they try to treat you that way. So that's, like, a perfect example. She found what worked for her, and that was yoga, and that's awesome.
Yeah.
Well, thank you, Tara.
Thank you, Jason. Thank you, everybody.
Thanks, everyone. So we're going to go to the World Wide Web. We have some questions.
Let's see, make sure everyone can hear me here. We do have questions online. So Rachel Foster is asking on Facebook, does yoga include meditation or are they two different things?
You want to go first?
Good question. I think meditation is yoga and meditation are both breathing based, and you know, for me, for instance, people always say, do you meditate? And I say, well, for me, yoga is meditation and motion. So I think yoga is movement with breath, and breath is breath and concentration, and breathing mindfully is meditation. Or you could, if you want to separate it, meditation is also just sitting and being quiet and breathing mindfully, and there are different, we could drill down on the different practices. So short answer is, yes, they can be two separate things, or for me personally, it's one thing, and that's yoga.
I feel the same way. I mean, how we always talk about yoga studio and beyond is, you know, you're finding yourself. So if you're practicing physical yoga and trying to do the pose and trying to be competitive and trying to get in a handstand, you're trying to do something else. But if you're practicing, you know, feeling into you, feeling into every inch of you, breathing, really being present, then that really is meditation in movement. And, you know, it's also useful to, you know, I just have a blanket right in my living room against the wall and I look at it and it, you know, I come from a Catholic background, so I get guilt-tripped into going and sitting and breathing for a couple minutes, and you know, and that works as well. So I think having both practices, you know, fitted in your schedule, it's really useful.
And you always say too, like, you don't need an altar, you don't need a yoga, you don't need all these special things. If you can breathe, you can do yoga, and if you breathe, you can meditate, and that's it. It's that simple. Now we're going to go to the audience questions.
Thank you very much to the panel. You guys have been great and insightful. My question is, and I'll use the analogy, I'm a runner, but they say, you know, you run once a week, twice a week, you don't really see the benefit. You do it three times a week, you really start seeing the benefit. And interestingly enough, growing up, my father had a bad back, and back in the 70s, I watched my father do yoga, so he was ahead of his time. But I guess my main question is, what do you recommend, or if you don't have a lot of time, what is the minimum practice? And maybe it's even at home, but is it like 2-3 days a week that you really start seeing benefits?
I always try to encourage people to do it every day. I mean, even if it's 5 minutes right when you get up in the morning, just to do that before you know, make your tea or whatever you're doing. There's also, you know, I'm from Illinois and nobody's doing yoga there. My little farm community, I'm from a farm town. So, you know, I started making videos for them online. That's how I got into like YouTube stuff. And I was like, here's something you can do on the couch. Here's something you can do in bed. So there really is like really simple practices that you can do for 5 minutes every day that don't, you know, especially if you're, you know, everybody has busy lives. Like if you don't have time to find a studio, go there. You know, it's a 3 hour ordeal once you get in the commute and all of that. So I think daily works. I mean, you're right on with the how many times. I think, you know, a lot of people that do it once a week, sure, you'll get relaxed and you'll feel more benefits. But if you're doing it for longer, 3 times a week is fantastic. And if you really just want to make it a very simple daily practice, 5 minutes in the morning really sets everything up nice. So.
And it really does make a difference. Like there are days, like when I first started practicing, I would practice 3 days a week pretty religiously. And then with work and travel, like that became more difficult. And even if I just did like 5 minutes, like it just made a huge difference.
Do you do it in the hotel rooms?
Like on the subway in New York or the subway platform, I'll do standing forward bends. So they'll be like, who's this guy just
and
bending
everybody's
over?
Everybody's weird in New York doing all kinds of crazy stuff.
So people just
stuff,
walk by.
So like, whatever.
Oh, he's just a weird guy. but anywhere, anytime. There's a...
We have a question back here.
I would like to ask that a lot of people that I know that do yoga for fertility, mostly I know as women, can yoga help men if they have problems with fertility?
I'm sure. Ask me next year.
No. I mean, one of the, I think, overarching, very awesome benefits of yoga with, you know, whether it's specifically fertility for men or whatever, is it gives your body space to work properly. And you may have something that's wrong that you will never develop into something that's wrong if you're keeping all of those systems working and pumping inside. So it really is, you know, allowing yourself to be at ease so you can function properly. So I would say absolutely. I mean, it works for everything. It should include that too. So, yeah.
Another question.
Actually, this is a statement to tell him what had worked for me in yoga and the audience. I think when there's a will, there's a way. Let's say if you wake up at 7 o'clock, wake up at 6:30, and do 30 minutes of yoga daily. Consistency works. And the body heals itself when it's in tune and relaxed. That's what I wanted to say. Thank you.
Right on.
Okay, so we're back. So on Twitter, we have a few different questions. People heard you say YouTube videos. Not everybody knows that you have such a prolific presence on YouTube. So maybe you could tell people where they can find you and what to expect when they get there?
Sure.
You have like 100 million views or something.
I know, there's a few of
you have more views than like NBC now.
Isn't that great about the internet? I started a page. It's if you just search my name on YouTube, Tara Stiles, it'll pop up. The channel's called Tara Stiles Yoga, and I have all kinds of very short and some longer routines. There's playlists for beginners. There's playlists that focus on things like sleep, and there's playlists that focus on gaining strength, flexibility. There's playlists for meditation. I just started really getting into cooking and eating a lot healthier because that's what happens when you do yoga, and the brain insula thing starts to say, eat your vegetables. So I started making all these pretty simple cooking videos, and I think that's another area that, not to go too much into food right now, but that's another area I know, at least for me, it's very overwhelming about how to eat healthy, and is everything tofu and kale and all this stuff. So I just, coming from the Midwest again, I'm like, what are the simple things that I can make in 5 minutes that'll help me feel connected to myself in the same way that yoga does? So it has a lot of those videos as well. And I do YouTube videos for other channels as well, for Live Strong Woman channel. So we do a lot of, and they look nicer. They have more production value than mine do. But they're, in some beautiful home in the Hollywood Hills overlooking an infinity pool and things like that. So they're all over the internet if you just search my name.
What is the most commonly asked question of people that come into your studio for the first time that have fertility issues?
Well, honestly, a lot of people that I've known, they don't ask right away. It's sort of this dating game with me. They want to see if they feel comfortable and this whole am I going to like it here? Am I going to feel relaxed? And they often just ask, is it going to work? I can't make any promises. I think is it going to work? It depends on what that means, like having, you know, getting pregnant, having a successful pregnancy and, you know, family and all of that. But oftentimes I just, you know, encourage people to get connected to themselves, and then things start to happen, and yeah, whatever the things that happen for them are the things that are supposed to happen for them, and they end up working.
Interesting interplay with the other room, which is about people getting or optimizing pregnancy potential when you're 40 plus. Folks are talking about stress and conception. It seems like there's definitely a corollary that maybe you could address here for that audience as well that's online.
Sure. I mean, stress is, you know, again, Deepak and his friend Dr. Rudy Tanzi, they go into like all this detail about how stress is the number one killer. You know, it's, yeah. It kills more people than anything else. And, you know, yoga is, you know, I think the main benefit is, you know, it allows you to deal with the situations in your life. So whatever you're going through, it's not that it's okay and everything's roses and ponies and rainbows, right. But you're able to deal with it a little bit easier, and you can gain more perspective in the situation when the situation is actually happening. So, you know, even if that's having a fight with your boss, you can have that space. Even if that's going through treatments that are very painful and stressful and emotionally taxing, you can still have that sense of grace and calm and ease. And all that stuff is happening in the brain, it's expanding in the body. You know, the room inside of ourselves is sort of unlimited, so it's kind of neat. Like you'll start to feel this and experience this when you meditate and practice. You feel that grand sense of room inside. And you know, every inhale creates a little bit more space. It's like opening a door, and every exhale just walks you into that new space. So the fuller and deeper you breathe, the more room inside opens. And I think that's a nice way that I like to think about. The more space you have around yourself, the more calm and at ease you feel, and you can deal with whatever's coming at you.
There's this great fact that I think the number one time when heart attacks occur is 9 a.m. on Monday. And if that's not a sign that stress can cause these types of things, I don't know what it is. So, another question.
You asked a good one. Is that close? Okay, good. You asked, what do people ask? When they come to the studio, and I'm the husband, I see a lot of the online traffic of people who can't ever make it to a studio but are following Tara online or on television, and it's often poses. So we've been taught, I think, that yoga is about poses, and so they ask, you know, what are the poses that I should do? And when Tara talks about yoga and Strala, and when Christine was sharing her experience, it wasn't about the poses at all. It was about how you yoga. So, you know, Tara mentioned you can practice by struggling and fighting against me, or you can practice ease and, relaxing into your life. And when Tara talks about space, it's... remembering that we're not a fixed thing, that we're actually plastic. Tara's friend Deepak talks about neuroplasticity all the time. So it's by the how we practice, we're literally rewiring our bodies to be more conducive to health or more conducive to dis-ease. So it's entirely up to us how we create that wiring. So it's not a what poses that are so much important as it is a well, what are you going to practice? Because the how you practice is what you get good at and what creates those wiring conditions for your body.
I think going after the feeling of feeling connected instead of, you know, we were outside a little bit ago with Stacy, and she has this lower back thing, so I was like showing her this, you know, thing you can do. She was like, oh, I can't get over as far as you. And I was like, well, it doesn't matter. Like, I have a totally different body, and I do this every day, and who cares? You know, it's not like you get a golden ticket if your head touches the floor. But if you feel better and you create that space, going after that feeling is much more expansive than going after, you know, being in a position.
Yeah, I don't think a specific pose is going to change your life, but practicing and moving will make you feel a lot better. It's pretty much guaranteed.
I have a two-part question. The first part is, in every major city, you have your plentiful of studios, from your Bikrams to, you know, Core Powers and Tri Vinyasa, and they have the hot yoga, and there's all these styles and different things. So it could be confusing for somebody who's just starting out. Yeah. And what your husband spoke about was not the poses. What's important to see when you go into a studio as far as the practice, the teacher, the community, and things like that. And my second question is, what does Strala Yoga stand for you?
Sure, yeah. Well, the first one, you know, I think it's wherever you are, you have to feel at home and comfortable. So if you go into a place and you're like, I don't know, I don't really connect here, it doesn't have to be like, oh, I walked into my own living room. But I think it's important to feel like you like what the teacher is saying, you like what they stand for, you kind of, you feel comfortable there. And then as far as the class goes, you know, not to be negative about a bunch of different styles, but if you have a teacher that's saying push, force, if it hurt, if it doesn't hurt, it doesn't feel good, that's, you know, not that that's not yoga, because yoga has become this huge umbrella, but that's not necessarily going to help you feel connected and at ease. But if you want just that army drill sergeant workout, then that's sort of that kind of a thing. And then the second question was with Strala, I was like a weird kid growing up. I'd go off to the woods and like meditate in trees, and I'd ask Deepak and his friend Rudy later, because I would see colors everywhere and all this stuff would happen to me, and I'd come back and be like, Mom, like I see these colors and like we're all connected. And she's like, what are you, so don't tell anybody, you have to do like therapy or something.
What are you drinking?
And I'm like, creek water, you know, but I always felt this like sense of everybody's connected, and that has to do with a practice of allowing ourselves to feel at ease and to also feel expansive. So, and it was always like this big like emotional feeling fest until I really started to like find other people that did yoga, and I knew, figured out that yoga was something that you do. So with Strala, we put a bunch of words together because I wanted to start a studio that you know, wasn't like breathe or bend or something that's very final, because I had this grand feeling sort of thing inside of me that was weird. So so it combined strength, balance, and awareness. And so I did all the trademarks and all that stuff you have to do when you start a business. And then I found out in Swedish it means to radiate light, and there's all these cool things that are about radiation, and that's how I've always felt when I was a kid, so I thought it was kind of a happy coincidence. So, yeah. But I think you can find that with whatever you're doing, too. It's not that, like, Strala is the answer, and I don't want to be like, everybody must do what I'm doing, you know, because I think that's a little bit not easeful in itself, but you can find that, you know, mowing the lawn, or you can find that in a Bikram class if Bikram's really what, you know, works for you, and you can find that however you find that, I think is important.
We have some more questions from the internet.
There are a lot. There's a couple of questions. I'll let you decide what you
think. Probably my mom.
It's not. So one is people noticing that you're talking about, others in the room as well, talking about running, and people asking, does that implies discipline? What kind of discipline does this does yoga require in terms of helping fertility? There's also... well, maybe that's the best thing for you to go with, because it seems like there's more volume on that question related to running and discipline in terms of getting a result for fertility using yoga and meditation.
So, I think anything you do requires a level of commitment or discipline. Like we were saying earlier, like a minimum, you know, we were talking about, do you need to go to do yoga 3 days a week, or can you just do it here and there? I do think whatever you do, there needs to be some sort of consistency. But I know that's difficult for some people, and I would then say something is better than nothing. I think yoga is one of those things that if you just do it here and there, you're going to feel better. So even if you do 10 minutes and then don't do it again for 2 weeks, after that 10 minutes, you're going to feel better. So it is a little different than running in other sports, but I would say, like, try to commit to it, and, you know, even if you're shopping around for a class or a teacher, like, shop around, try to find something that works for you. Go to Tara's YouTube channel. I think like anything, you got to give it a shot, and commit to giving it a shot. Set up a timeline that works for you and stick with it, and then say, I'm going to give this 5 days or whatever you come up with, and then after that, make a decision, does this work for me or not?
I would echo that same thing. The more you practice, the better you feel. So it's just a nice feeling to go after, instead of the more you practice, the more results you have. So just, you know, it's just a nice thing to know that it's going to feel good every time. And, you know, if you go into a class and you have a teacher that's pushing and you're worried about getting injured, you know, just find another class. And, you know, I like to encourage people to enlist their friends. If you're doing it with your partner or your coworkers or your buddy, then it's something that you do together and you're more likely to go than you know, if you're just doing it on your own, especially as a beginner.
A good rule of thumb, I think, you know, ask yourself, does it feel good? If so, then proceed. If not, like, stop and do something else.
And we weave that right into the instructions of the studio. I say, you know, if it hurts, back off. You know, don't push through. And, you know, if it feels good, that's great. Keep going. You know, we have a lot of people just, you know, relaxing in child's pose halfway through or, you know, doing something they don't feel like they have to do, you know, or they have to, you know, tensely do all of the poses in the class or all of the movements. So it's very important to, you know, follow how you feel and to practice following how you feel, because it's hard, you know, all day long if we're, you know, doing all these things in our life that we set up, it's, you know, we're not following how we feel. When we're driving, we have to follow the traffic lights, you know, right. So it's important.
That's your one rule that we shouldn't break.
That's my one rule, yeah, traffic lights. But
follow those.
Yeah, but with yoga, it's all about you, and I think that is a hard practice because, you know, it's you time, and that's like a big magnifying glass, a big mirror, like, okay, wow, I'm feeling this, that's interesting.
There are more questions. I know we have limited time, yeah. So I can ask this, and you can decide how you want to handle it.
Sure.
Somebody heard the mention of Bikram yoga,
sure.
And they're wondering, you know, they've heard competitive yoga and other kinds of yoga seem to be coming out all of the time. What type of yoga is right for fertility, and what will help me if I'm planning to go through an IVF cycle next week?
Oh, wow. You know, not to put, you know, Bikram or any of these competitive styles down, but if you can find the ease in Bikram, then you're probably already really, really, really relaxed. Yeah. But I think a lot of people who go to these more power classes, like, they want that sort of, like, type A burn already.
Right.
You know, with the styles of what we do, it's more gentle, more easeful, and even in our more athletic classes, we have classes that involve all kinds of, like, you know, tricks and things people are doing all kinds of cool things with their bodies, but they're all approached with ease. So I think generally if you're just looking, you know, in the YouTube videos, everything that I do has that effect. If you're going into a class, you know, I would look for the more gentle classes. You don't have to go necessarily restorative. That's, you know, lying, you know, pretty much propped up on bolsters and stuff. If that sort of thing appeals to you, then that's great. But I would look for a more slower flow or more relaxing class and start there to just really give yourself that space to feel good. Especially if you're a beginner, you might not want to go into a, you know, level 25, you know, whatever class. Everybody's going to be balanced on one finger, and you're just going to be sitting there like, what am I doing here?
So the reason why things like yoga and acupuncture, they work in helping people conceive, is they help you relax and feel at ease. So if you're doing anything, whether it be a yoga class where you're not feeling that, where you're feeling like you're being competitive and pushing isn't going to probably help you conceive. It's the opposite of that. So that's like the key thing to remember in anything you do. Like if gardening, you know, helps you be at ease and relax, then do that. Like that's the key takeaway. That's the feeling you want to look for. So find whatever provides you with that, and yoga happens to be like one of those, yeah. It's like the thing that I think does it better than anything, then go with it.
I would look for studios without mirrors too. We don't have mirrors up. A lot of people come in, they're like, where's the mirror? And I'm like, in the bathroom. So you check to see if you have some of your teeth. I was like, what do you need mirrors for in yoga? You know, it's, you're going inside. You know, I'll make sure like your knees are over your ankles and everything's okay. Like you're not gonna get hurt. We're gonna go slow. But you know, you don't need to be like, you know, checking out your whole thing. No mirrors.
I think we're out of time. This flew by. So
thank you for being here. It's been wonderful.
Thanks everyone for coming. Thank you, Tara, for sharing your amazing stories and for getting all these people pregnant.
It's all Christine.
And thanks everyone for tuning in.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Have a great day.